So I'm there doing my thing, minding my business, keeping my head low, and the compere for the evening unexpectedly says, "We have Mr. Hall here from the UK. Would you like to come up and say some words?" In this video, I'm going to show you how embracing misery can put you on the path to true fulfillment. Now, on my journey as an entrepreneur, the hardest lesson that I had to learn was that the number one limiting factor to my success
was me.
It wasn't the market, it wasn't the white man, well, maybe, but that's a topic for another video. It wasn't my customers, it wasn't the fact that I had a bad service, it wasn't the competition, or it wasn't my team. It took me almost 2 decades to figure out 3 seemingly miserable approaches to success. Well, in the UK, it's a little bit corny to talk about success.
I love corn.
I'll talk more about fulfillment because you can check me out online and decide whether or not you think I'm successful. But what I can tell you deliberately is that I am fulfilled in the work that I do, which I know most people can't say. And those 3 approaches, well, if they worked for me, could they work for you? Let's find out. Now, the first miserable realization is that whatever happens in your life, good or bad, is probably, scratch that, not probably, is your fault. Albert Einstein famously said, "You can't blame gravity for falling in love." Now, there's a simple psychology that really grabbed my attention about a decade ago, and that was around your ego. So if you are trying to do something new that you could potentially fail at, your ego will put you in a place to protect you because it wants you to feel good. And it will set up this dynamic where it will make you feel as if when something does go wrong, that it's not your fault. It's an external factor. It's someone or something else that's caused this thing to go wrong, because then that still puts you in a position of feeling great when actually your ego is doing you a disservice. So over here in the UK, and there's a term which we use, which I believe comes from my Jamaican heritage, which is being wrong and strong. Do you know anyone that out? Do you know anyone like that? Now, if you know anyone who's remotely like me, the irony of it is that I am exactly the type of person who would be wrong and strong. And chances are, well, actually not chances are, the fact is I have been wrong and strong in my past, and it's only been through pure pain and
misery
that I've had to admit to myself that things aren't working out in the way that I had proposed. Now, what I now do, and what I've done for the last decade and a half perhaps, is instead of thinking and taking the default position that I'm correct, if I am going to start a new company, a new project, a new initiative, I always assume that I am incorrect until data, information, facts and feedback from the market prove me otherwise, because then it almost gives me an empty cup by which to fill up new information and to determine, well, whoever it is I'm selling to, whether or not I'm selling impact, I'm selling books, I'm selling a YouTube video, it's actually the data, the information that I'm getting, the feedback that I'm getting from the market that will determine whether or not I am on the right path, as opposed to me feeling like I am on the right path. And in doing so, you measure different things. So if you look back at the history of myself as an entrepreneur and the organization that I run, Ultra Education, we have won to date maybe 15 awards over the last 8 to 10 years, which sounds great, except that I know that there are months when we have won awards, but we've not made enough money to cover the bills. There are different kind of faces and perspectives to success, and I have had to rationalize which one is more important. Is it more important to look good, or is it more important to actually be good? Now, there's a lyric from a rapper called Fonte in a group called Little Brother who sums this up perfectly.
"Yeah, every now and then you gotta ask yourself, do you really wanna win or just look good losing?"
Now, the second miserable strategy that I employ in my life on a day-to-day basis is the concept of equanimity, which is a term that I came across when I was listening to an interview with the legendary Russell Simmons when he was promoting a book called Success Through Stillness. Now, this concept of equanimity essentially suggests that if things get too bad, don't be too depressed about it. But conversely, if things go too well, don't get too excited about it, which I know sounds a little bit
depressing.
But check this out. I recently came across a video with Ali K. Jones, who was an ex-member of Said Lunatics, the famous group with Nelly in it.
"It's getting hot in here."
Where he said this.
"I didn't want the fame, because once you taste, you're gonna swallow. Now you're full of yourself. It just automatically is going what it is. Once you start getting that and you get that fame and you start tasting that and you You live forward.
Now, if you look at the highlight reel of my own journey and that of the company over the last 10 years, it would look like everything's perfect, which is what socials are for, right? But in all of that success, I was mindful to not let any of that go to my head and to swallow it and become full of myself. I always remember an instance about 18 months ago where I was doing some filming with Virgin. So they came around to my place to capture me working as part of this campaign and to do a little interview. And I remember being there with literally almost 20 people set up, lighting, cameramen, art director, producer, runners. And I was like, wow. And I was like, wow, I feel like a bit of a star here. But thinking equanimously, no, that's not the word. But using this concept of equanimity, I knew that when the lights had turned off and the cameras were gone, I had to get back to work and make sure that we hit our targets that month. There's also a great clip from none other than Robert De Niro, who sums this up perfectly.
Things just be calm. When things are going well, be calm. Don't think you're on top of the world in the sense. You always got to be wary because I've seen it. I've seen people come. I've seen people go. I've seen them come. I've seen them go. You got to be chill.
Now, on the flip side, I've also been guilty of not celebrating success when it does come along, even to a sober degree. So I made sure that when we won our last award, which was our Virgin Unite Founders Award, that I deliberately went and celebrated by taking the team out for a slap-up meal. But more practically, this idea of equanimity, particularly when things don't go well, because honestly, there are challenges every day and bad news all the time, just like any entrepreneurial journey. But I've managed to develop a strategy that protects me against the But I've managed to develop a way of thinking that can protect me against the downside of bad news. One of those ways is to not rely on any particular deal or partnership and to have enough leads going into the top of the funnel that if half of those leads do not become business, that we're still okay. And in situations where things really go wrong, whether it's something that's really upsetting, there could be some conflict. One of the practical reasons that I personally make sure that I remain in a state of equanimity is because, much like most of us, I'm sure, human beings out here, when you get angry or you lose your cool, it can have a significant impact on your central nervous system. And I don't know about you, but if I get angry or mad or upset, that feeling can stay with me for some time. It almost feels as if something internally has dismantled and it will take some time to reform. And in that time, I'm no longer productive because I'm thinking about the mess I've just made, the argument I've just had, the fallout, whatever it might be. And it's not necessarily the situation, it's what you do in this situation that can have the knock-on effect that we may want or not want. And in an article by Thrive Global on whether or not anger kills brain cells, it says, "Can anger cause neurological damage? Anger triggers a release of cortisol, and one of the results of cortisol is an increase in the uptake of calcium ions through the cell membranes of your neurons, aka brain cells. This increased uptake of calcium ions causes your nerve cells to fire too frequently and can lead to their deaths. So stay calm even in bad situations. I know it sounds difficult, but if you practice it long enough, it'll become part of your behavior. I'm not saying for those emotionally intelligent people out there that you shouldn't feel bad feelings when they come and you shouldn't process them. But if you keep exploding every time something doesn't go your way, you won't have much left. Now, the third and for me, most important miserable strategy that I've come to realize has massively benefited me in all areas of my life is this, that if growth requires discomfort, that it is in your best interest to engineer discomfort so that you are growing on your own terms and that when your comfort zones are pushed unexpectedly, you are ready for it. To live is to suffer. To survive is to find meaning in that suffering. Friedrich Nietzsche. Now, true story, I thought DMX came up with that line in arguably one of the best songs he's put out called Slipping.
To live, to suffer, to survive, well, that's to find meaning in the suffering.
Now, to give you an example of what I'm talking about, we know as humans, one of the greatest fears is that of public speaking. So when I started along my journey as an entrepreneur, I would accept every public speaking opportunity that came my way, whether I was ready for it or not. And as a result, I became used to standing in front of audiences of 5, 50, and sometimes 2,000 people to talk about what I did. I remember being invited to speak at a conference in Dominica some years back. And prior to the conference, there was a banquet with all of the most important delegates from around the Caribbean, South America, and the States. So I'm there doing my thing, minding my business, keeping my head low, and the compere for the evening unexpectedly says, "We have Mr. Hall here from the UK. Would you like to come up and say some words?" And it was one of those requests where you couldn't really turn it down. Now, I was looking at this audience of VIPs thinking, "Julian, you cannot fluff this." However, I got up because, again, I was used to getting up in front of audiences where they were important people. I was able to go up, look at everyone in front of me, thank the individual compere, made a comment about a joke he made, talked about my trip over, and talked about how excited I was about the initiative that I was there to support. And in that time, I was able to ramble on for 2 or 3 minutes, make the audience laugh, and go back and sit down. That window of opportunity that I was able to grab and do something great with meant that I grew my network, and it created another 3 years worth of business for me as an entrepreneur in that region. Most of you who know me will know that I live in the gym. I'm always there. I love working out, whether it's cardio, whether it's weights. And in that game, you will deliberately add more pounds or kilograms to the bar. In the world of cardio, you will deliberately try to run faster at a greater pace on a steeper incline, because you know that even though it feels miserable in the moment, that it will make you stronger and fitter. The same behavior type I carry into business. So as an example, when we ran our first kids business fair in 2016, we had around 25 kid entrepreneurs. First time anyone had seen something like that, and there was no reason for me to grow it or change it. But because I wanted to add more kilograms to the bar and I wanted to improve my time, the next year, well, it was actually 6 months later, we doubled the amount of kid entrepreneurs that we had in the venue. And 9 years later, we would have grown that number by at least 8 times. But that's me deliberately pushing myself and the team outside of our comfort zones, because the reason why we're doing it is more important than the pain, discomfort, and misery in the moment that we're feeling in growing the impact of the work that we're doing. And actually, if we are passionate enough about it, just like I'm passionate about working out, that we know that that feeling will go and we'll actually become stronger at the end of it. So in conclusion, fulfillment doesn't come about by skipping through the fields on a bright sunny day. Life, unfortunately, isn't a fairy tale, and we have to do the work on ourselves in order for that work to impact other areas of our life, whether it's personal or professional. The work won't be done for us. We have to look and decide, what is it that we need to work on and engineer discomfort to think about what is it, what is it about me that is limiting the growth of my success in my personal life or in my business? And what can I do deliberately to create that discomfort, which can then create that growth? And if it's something that you're passionate about, that temporary feeling of misery will then lead to a longer lasting feeling of fulfillment. And if you think about that as a process that you might need to motivate yourself for, at some point, if you can keep doing that, it'll turn into a behavior, which will turn into a lifestyle, which will turn into your personality. And that's it for today's video, guys. How have you turned something miserable into something which has helped to propel yourself and your business forward? Do share in the comments below. And if you want to know why, which way am I pointing for the video? Is it that way? And if you want to know why I think networking is a complete waste of time and what you should do instead, then click the link over here and I'll catch you on the next video. Ultra and out.
It's getting hot in here.